Okay, you can turn your Bible to Daniel, the book of Daniel, chapter 2. Starting in verse 20. It says here, Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness." It's going to be important in this study. "And the light dwelleth with him. I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who hast given me wisdom and might, and hast made known unto me now what we desired of thee, for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter." Speaking of King Nebuchadnezzar, the dream that he had, the vision that he had of the future. But this is very true for what the Lord has revealed to us for this study. The Lord has revealed the truth to us. We're not going to take any credit for it. Amen. We're not professional researchers and whatever else, and by our own intellect we've done this. No, far from it. We're just a bunch of sinners, just two sinners, saved by grace. Wretched, vile, filthy, wicked people that are saved. The Lord chose to save us. And verse 27 of the same chapter says, "Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, The secret which the king hath demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days." What the Lord has shown us is what is going to be in the latter days and what is right now. And these occultists, which you read about there in verse 27, the wise men, you know, witches and wizards and things, they think that they're wise. The astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers. Your knowledge is limited to what the devils that control you will tell you. And what you don't realize is that you are being used as pawns in the game. We have seen these things here, and it is because the Lord has revealed these to us. What your plans are, the kind of things that are being done, and we're going to show you. I'm not going to build to the climax and oh boy, what's he? You know, we're building up to this thing. I'm going to tell you right now what this video is going to be about, what the Lord has shown us. Okay, the tie-ins between witchcraft, the Mandela effect, CERN, the Vatican, the Jesuits, the Mark of the Beast. And some other things we're going to be kicking along the way as well. Okay, this is big stuff, right? We have been working very hard on this. We already have. It's kind of weird because we already did earlier today. We did a video, Camtasia video, showing us going to different websites, already proving a lot of these links. That's going to be part two. This is going to be part one. So forgive us if we kind of repeat some things in the next video. You know, trying to remember here, but. It's very interesting. If you've been following this ministry and other ministries, you've probably heard of this thing called the Mandela effect. And we're going to be showing that it's a satanic witchcraft spell. And I know the witches out there are freaking out right now saying, "We don't worship Satan. We don't worship Satan." Well, that's because you're low level, okay? If you become high level enough, you'll realize that yes, you do worship Lucifer, your high priestesses and whatever other idiots run your organization, they all worship Lucifer, just as the Jesuits worship Lucifer, just as the heads of the Vatican worship Lucifer. Again, low-level Catholics. That's not true. We worship Jesus. You worship Lucifer. That's why the Easter Masses for the last number of years have been sung to Lucifer and says Christ is your son. So don't tell me, oh, Lucifer is our way of saying Jesus. No, it isn't. No, it isn't. You're devil worshipers. Your salvation as a Roman Catholic is based upon cannibalism, human sacrifice and cannibalism. And I'll use your terms, human sacrifice. I wouldn't say that human, but another issue there. But what I'm going to show you today, because they say, well, the King James Bible has been changed, which I'll say more about that in a minute. What I'm going to show you today, I have four King James Bibles, other than my normal Cambridge Bible that I've used for years and years and years. I bought this thing in probably about 2002, 2003, something like that. I don't remember the exact year, but it's fairly new. But I have, over here, I have a small one here. This is an 1828 King James Bible, a large pulpit Bible. That is 1846. A smaller King James Bible here, not as little as the top one there. That one is 1868. And then I have an authorized version, revised version, parallel Bible that's from 1892. Printed in those years. Not reproduction or something like this. These are all very old books. The oldest one being nearly 200 years old in my collection. These are the oldest Bibles that I own. All right, I have reprints of the 1610 or 1611, excuse me. Well, actually the 1610 Dewey Reams too. But I have reprints. These aren't reprints. These are originals. So if the King James Bible has been changed, the newer King James Bibles are changed, well then those old ones there should line up with the supposed, they should, you know, not be corrupted like our supposed new King James ones here are. Not to be confused with the new version called the New King James Version. But what this study is going to show you, and here's the interesting part, not only do we have cooperation at the highest levels of witchcraft and the Vatican, Jesuitry, and other organizations, not only are they working in unison, CERN, the scientists, you know, the atheistic scientists at CERN, they're also in on this whole thing. It's all tying into the Mark of the Beast, folks. I mean, it's incredible stuff the Lord showed us.
And if you're denying that this information exists on your websites, the Lord gave me hard copies printed.
Yeah.
You cannot duck the issue, all you little atheists and Jesuits and witches out there.
Yeah.
I have it printed and backup copies too in other forms.
Yep. And we're in the other video we already did, we showed the websites. See, we have to say this because we've done this in the past and then the websites magically disappear.
Yes, or they get changed or removed and then people, and then they act like, oh, we don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, we never
about.
Said that stuff. Yeah, sure. Well, we're going to see about that. But here's the thing. Okay, let me say this. Number one, this video is going to prove that at the highest levels, witchcraft, witches, Catholics, Jesuits,
Masons,
One-Worlders, Masons, things, all work together. It's going to prove that. And number two, it's also going to prove that this book is God's book. You know why? Because they're all working together to try and get rid of it. Now, if this is just a book, if this King James Bible right here, if this is just some kind of a, it's just a translation, it's not really a holy book, it's not really that powerful, then why are all these top-level people trying to cast spells upon you to make you think differently? Mm-hmm. That this is not God's word. This is God's book, and you're not going to believe who all's involved in this conspiracy. And it is a conspiracy. Absolutely, we're going to be proving that today. So, and what we're going to do is we're going to show a lot of the conspiratorial angle of this thing, and then not sure if we'll be doing this in this part or in the final part, but we'll be showing the actual, I have a list of 8 verses here, the 8 most popular verses that have supposedly been changed in your modern editions of the King James Bible. And I'm going to show you from King James Bibles that are nearly 200 years old that it's a lie. I'm going to show you that. And I also have other evidence too, just in case those out there are screaming and shouting, well, all King James Bibles have been changed. Oh, we're going to see about that. We're going to see about that. I have a little trick up my sleeve. Okay. So, with that being said, we're going to go next to Daniel. The same book there. Actually, we're in the book of Daniel. Chapter 8. It says here, and in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full. You know, I got to stop there for a minute because it's so interesting. Because if you go back, keep your hand there in Daniel chapter 8. This is going to be some Bible. Not a whole lot of scripture today, but in this study, because we're going to be showing you a lot of other things. But we talk about scripture here. We rely on our King James Bibles and the ones that haven't been changed and won't be changed because it's a supernatural book that you stupid witches and Catholics and Jesuits, you hate this book. We know that. That's why you're trying to get rid of it by whatever means you can. Even being so idiotic as to try and convince people with your little stupid spells and things, you know, it's been changed. It doesn't work on those of us that are saved, okay? We have a spirit of discernment. The Holy Spirit guides us.
And we see through your sophistry because that's what it is.
Yep.
Propaganda.
Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. You say, what's the significance of that? Well, keep your hand there in Daniel, because we're coming right back there. But Matthew chapter 24, verse 36 says, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. And by the way, verse 35 says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Sorry to all you dumb Satanists out there that are really trying to deceive the gullible and the novice Christians and things that really don't know their Bibles that well yet. Sorry, you're the loser. Verse 37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. I actually saw somebody in one of the comments in one of my videos, they were like, my Bible says Noah. It's supposed to be Noah. It must have been changed. No, it hasn't been changed. The word Noah there is a word in Greek coming to English. In the Old Testament, it's Hebrew coming to English. It's the same word. It'd be the same thing as saying Pedro versus Peter. Or you know, Hans versus John. It's the same name, it's just different languages. Understand? All right? But notice it said there that in the end times, it's going to be the same as it was back there before the flood. You say, what's the significance? Back to Daniel chapter 8, verse 23. When the transgressors are come to the full. Now you got to get a hold of that thing. Because what's happening is God in his love and in his mercy is allowing people to have a free will to commit the sins that they want to sin. And he's saying, I'm going to put up with this thing. I'm going to be patient. I'm going to be long-suffering. I'm going to allow people to have their own way. So nobody can come and say, you forced us to do such and such. God doesn't force you to do anything. All right. You have a free will to accept or reject him. And right now, the transgressors are coming to the full. Okay? In other words, it's getting so wicked, you can't really go much farther. You have filled up that full wickedness where God's wrath now, he's justified. Even 10 years ago, I was just like, you know, wow, it's really bad. I can't imagine getting any worse. It's gotten a whole lot worse. And it gets worse by the day now. It's not even like, well, we can kind of see it year by year. It's getting a little worse. It's daily. It's daily. I mean, it's just disgusting and sick what's happening in this world. Why? The transgressors are come to the full. So now when God comes and he pours out his wrath on this earth, which you read about back in the book of Revelation, and Daniel too, you'll see this. God just pours out his wrath, just unsheathed, just anger and just fury upon the earth. Why? The transgressors came to the full. Every imagination of their heart was only evil continually, as in the days of Noah. So shall be in the days before the coming of the Son of Man. You understand? Oh, and by the way, for you dumb atheists out there, foolish atheists, excuse me, I'll use biblical terminology. For you foolish atheists out there, these books are written thousands of years apart. How is it that they all line up? Weird, isn't it? But let's continue. Verse 23. When the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance. He's going to be a very fierce man in his looks. Very fierce. And understanding dark sentences. What did Daniel say back there in chapter 2 about God reveals things that are dark? Witchcraft language, sophistry, Jesuitical sophistry that we've
Twilight
talked about.
Twilight language, secrets.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of the little secret things that they do, and they go, oh, we've made it look like it's just a happy little video from CERN or something, but we have secret hidden coded messages all through it. Yeah, guess what? The Lord understands that stuff. And guess what? He reveals it to people like us, uninitiated witches. Okay? We're not initiated.
As you say.
Yeah. All right? We're not witches. I'm saying we're uninitiated. We haven't been brought into your deep little secrets and stuff like this. You know, it's like a little bunch of children. Stupid.
And God understands the blasphemous tongue speaking of charismatics and Pentecostals too.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah.
Don't
witches,
try and get one by the Lord Jesus Christ. You stinking Satanists out there.
Yeah. But understanding dark sentences shall stand up. Mm-hmm. Verse 24. And his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. And he shall destroy wonderfully, and shall prosper and practice, and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. Oh boy, bunch of things there. Number one, his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. He is going to have high-tech means of destroying people. Kind of like CERN. Oh, but that's just a scientific research thing. Yeah, sure, right. I don't think so. I guarantee you that there's some kind of a weapon thing there with that, or some kind of a deal that they're going to use for mind control, or whatever other purposes they're going to use that thing for. Okay? Don't give me this thing. Oh, it's just, we're experimenting with time travel and whatever. We'll see about that as we continue. But they have weapons. So the Antichrist isn't going to be showing up and saying, I have power, I can send out, you know, lightning rays from my hands or something like this. No. He's going to have power, but it's going to be because of high technology weapons. And these people that are in these systems, again, they're atheistic in many ways, but they also practice witchcraft. And they're in bed with the Vatican. They'll do what the Vatican tells them to do. They're in the back pocket of the Pope, in other words. But notice it says there, and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. Why don't you read the book of Daniel? Particularly, go over to Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. Who's it talking about? Israel, the Jewish people. And what's the city? Jerusalem. So who would the holy people over here be in verse 24? The Jews. The Jewish people. You say, no, it can't be. They've rejected Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter. There's a covenant made with them. The Abrahamic covenant. Never been disannulled. Isn't that something? They're called the holy people even though they reject Jesus Christ. You know why they're called the holy people? Because it's their time. 70 weeks are determined upon them, not upon the body of Christ.
That's why it's called the time of Jacob's trouble.
In Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. That's right.
Jacob is a synonym for Israel.
No, it's the church. In the original Greek, it's... No, wait. The Old Testament's in Hebrew. Well, the original Hebrew. The original Swahili, maybe, or something like that? Yeah. No, Jacob is Israel. Okay? Thy holy people there. It's the Jews. Not the church. Like the Vatican Catholics teach. Replacement theology. But look at verse 25. And through his policy also he shall cause craft, witchcraft, to prosper in his hand. What do we read back in Revelation 13? There would be a mark in the right hand or in the forehead that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark.
Or the name or the number of the beast.
Yep. Yeah. Isn't that something? But keep that in mind. All right. I'm going to show you some pictures here in just a little bit, couple minutes here, that are really going to blow your mind. All right. Let's see where we are here. And he shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall destroy many. Oh, you got to love that. You're going to see that all throughout the second video where we're online, and we're showing all these articles from Jesuit sources, Jesuit articles online, and they're all saying, Nelson Mandela was a man of peace. He was peace. It was peace. It was peace. It was peace.
And also...
And it's funny because... Let me just say this real quick. Nelson Mandela is a man of peace. He got the... What was it? Nobel Peace Prize or whatever?
Uh-huh. Nobel Peace Prize laureate or...
Yeah, he got the Nobel Peace Prize. And yet the guy killed over 21,000 people in his country.
Of his own kind.
Yeah.
He murdered his own people.
Yeah. Yeah. And not just murdered. We're talking tortured. Yes. I mean, he would take, look up, type in, if you want to see the proof of this, type in, go to like Google or some other search engine or whatever, and type in Nelson Mandela. We're talking about the Mandela effect here, and you're going to see it's directly tied to him in the second video, through a witch. She founded it. What's her name?
Fiona Broom.
Fiona Broom.
Talk about it. Again,
and you're going to see the proof of that in the second video. You're going to see her website, her Facebook page, her connections, everything that she's into. She named the Mandela effect after Nelson Mandela. And you're going to see why that is so significant, why the thing of the right hand, why the mark of the beast, why how CERN fits into all this stuff. But it's interesting because he gets a peace prize and yet he's killed all these people. But what I was saying is look up Nelson Mandela necklacing. What they would do is they would take tires, car tires, old car tires, put fuel in them, either diesel or gasoline, and they'd put them around people's heads, and then they'd light the fuel, and it would literally burn the person's head off.
But slowly. The Jesuits in the Vatican claim they're not violent.
Yeah, Nelson Mandela is a man of peace. You're
sick if you think that necklacing, per Mandela's satanic regime, if you think that Mandela's torture-based non-violence scheme is non-violent, well then you're sick in the head. Mm-hmm. You're a sick individual if you think that necklacing is not wrong.
Yeah, and the other sick thing is Billy Graham. Billy Graham lauded Nelson Mandela. They were friends. Mm-hmm. Isn't that nice? And Franklin Graham did a nice little eulogy thing when Nelson Mandela died. And, oh, we've lost a great man. And he was a freedom fighter and stuff like this. The guy was in prison. Nelson Mandela went to prison as a terrorist. Mm-hmm. What was the ANC or something like that? What does that stand
African
for?
African National Congress.
African National Congress. They murdered all kinds of people. Why? Because of what they called apartheid. It means segregation.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted all the races to come together. Just like back in the book of Genesis with Nebuchadnezzar, or with not Nebuchadnezzar, but with Nimrod. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. But let's continue here. By peace shall destroy many. Nelson Mandela, there's been a bunch of people that have been test runs, dry runs for the Antichrist. Nelson Mandela was one of them. And award after award after award after award. I mean, everybody's giving this guy awards. And he's a hero. He's just this great man. And they have Nelson Mandela Day. I'm going to show you all the proof of this. It's insane. And how it ties into the Mandela Effect and CERN and witchcraft and Jesuitry. It says here, and he shall also stand up against the Prince of Princes, but he shall be broken without hand. All right? And just in case you're wondering where that happens, turn back to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation 19, verse 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. This is Jesus Christ we're talking about here. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Interesting, because that's exactly what they're attacking. All these little goons, these little jerks, they're trying to attack the book. The greatest book that's ever been. On the mountain of all these other wicked publications down here. Got the new banner there. We're going to be having that in some of the videos. Verse 14, and the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Can't wait for it. Verse 17, and I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, Come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast, and the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse, and against his army. All right? In other words, you little goons out there that are in witchcraft, or the Jesuits, or your Catholics, or whatever else, if you're young enough, you're going to be in that army. We're not that far from this thing coming to pass, all right? Your little New World Order, United Nations, all the nations coming together. Your little one world government army, 200 million man army if you do the study there in Revelation. But look what happens, verse 20. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone, and the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. What did Daniel chapter 8, verse 25 say? But he shall be broken without hand. The sword comes out of Jesus' mouth. What is it that destroys this Antichrist system in the end? This book.
The King James Bible.
Yeah. You say, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. It's been done away with. CERN has changed the King James Bible. Okay, Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Hasn't been fulfilled yet. If the word of God is no more, then how are people slain for the word of God in the future? And how is it that Jesus Christ comes back and his word comes out of his mouth? He comes back as the manifest word of God, but yet it's the written word of God, I believe, that comes out of his mouth and slays this 200 million man United Nations army. The Bible hasn't been changed, nor will it ever be changed. The King James Bible. The other ones from the Vatican, yeah, they change them all the time. The NIV, the ESV, the NASV, the NRSV, all the other satanic junk. And they are satanic, too, by the way. And I just want to say this while I'm on that subject of the new versions. A lot of us King James Bible believers have a lot of grace for the people that have come out and attacked our Bible, this King James Bible. And we get charged with not having grace. Of course, you know, of course, we never get charged with that.
No.
Yeah. But, you know, we've had a lot of grace. But let me tell you something. If you attack this King James Bible, you knowingly attack it, you're a servant of hell. You are a servant of Satan. And God is going to deal harshly with you. You better repent quickly. Because this study is going to prove that, in fact, the powers that be, these wicked people, I'm going to be showing you some pictures here, these wicked people are, in fact, coming together to try and destroy people's faith in the King James Bible. So, having given that as a little bit of an introduction here, let me start showing you some pictures. Okay, no, not that one. All right, let me think of where to start out here. There was a video that came out. It's called something about CERN. We are happy at CERN. It was a university. A bunch of students went there, and they're doing all these dances and everything else. And on the surface, it just looks like they're goofy, fun, kind of whatever. But then when you actually start to break down some of the symbolism and things, and I really don't care to go through the whole thing. It's just a bunch of idiot witches putting the thing out. They think that this has got some we of power because we've put out this secret thing. They're like a bunch of little stupid children. It's funny, actually. But this one part of the video, there's a older guy sitting in this office. Let me show you the picture here. You can see there the name of the video, We Are Happy at CERN, USLHC. You can just type that in YouTube search and you can see the video. It's got this horribly annoying music in it. But you can see this guy here. Let me show you a closer up picture of it. Okay, there's this guy. Looks like some kind of hippie or something like this. You know, that era, long hair and whatever. But it says there, he has a little sign there in paper written, We are happy at CERN. Okay, then he's got, and you can get into all the little, you know, details of this thing, but bond number one on a sign there, and then Mandela underneath that. Okay, you can see that pretty clearly.
With a mathematical equation of some sort on his t-shirt.
Yeah. I mean, when you're back farther away from him, you can see the Mandela a lot closer. I can show that there. But I'll show you here. Okay, this would be a better picture of it there. Okay, yeah. That's kind of more the zoomed in thing there. But you can see Mandela and bond number one. You see, what's the significance of that? Well, first of all, you have to understand that this Fiona Broom that came up with this term Mandela effect, watch the second video, the second part there, because we actually show her website and show what she's been involved with. She's a witch. I mean, just obviously a witch. She doesn't come right out and say, I'm a witch, but of course they don't when they're higher level witches like that.
But she makes it blatantly obvious on her Facebook profile, which we showed in its entirety,
mm-hmm.
the fact you know, her educational background and then her other section of her Facebook profile that has all these satanic buzzwords.
Yep.
And if you understand what the buzzwords are, you can spot them jumping off the page at you.
She's Harvard educated, and she talks about alternate realities all the time, and she's talking about this spirit of this and this that, and she's a psychic. She goes paranormal stuff. She's always going out and doing hunts for ghosts and stuff like this.
Alternate memories.
Yeah.
Memory triggers, which is a trigger word for programming purposes.
Sure. And she's tied in with other witches and stuff, which we've proved in the second study. But notice this picture here. This is the very first James Bond made-for-television movie. I think it came out in 1954 or something. But it's who's the main actor? Well, you can see here it says Barry Nelson. Okay? So this loser at the CERN thing has Bond number one, James Bond, the number one movie, with Barry Nelson. So Bond number one, Nelson Mandela.
Mandela
Barry
effect.
Nelson Mandela. All right? How about that? So it isn't that this nutty witch came up with this Mandela effect talking about CERN, and the people at CERN don't know about this. They know about it. And they're given a little subtle, little witchcraft, little coded language thing, dark sentences, you know, like your Bible talks about. They're doing this little thing as a little wink, wink, you know, to those who are in the know.
Mm-hmm.
Of course they are. And you can see another part of the video. They go through the different elements, and fire, water, whatever, other things, you know. And they have the one part where they show fire crew and the people are out dancing around. And they just happen to have two fire engines. The one is number 32, the other is number 33 for the 32nd and 33rd degrees of Freemasonry. They don't show any numbers from any of the other fire engines, just number 32 and number 33.
Which are Shriner-level Masonic degrees.
Yeah. So, childish, bunch of stupid little nonsense. But, let me see here what else I want to show on this for now. Okay. So, you know, watch the second part and you'll see the proof of this thing, of this woman being a witch and talking about alternate realities and everything else. And that's what she's trying to get you to believe. If you believe, if you fall for this thing of the Mandela effect, that it's they're altering reality and stuff like this, they've changed your King James Bible, what they're trying to get you to do is enter into an alternate reality. Because, I mean, really, if it's true, and it's not, it's nonsense, but if it's true, well, then what would be your standard of truth? It can't be the King James Bible anymore because it's being changed. You don't have any say in the matter. They're somehow magically changing it with their scientific machines, which would mean, of course, that Satan and his people are more powerful than God, because the Bible clearly says that it's not going to be changed. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. So, interesting. But getting back to this thing of this Nelson Mandela, what's the deal with Nelson Mandela? Well, I thought this was rather interesting. There's a campaign. When Nelson Mandela went to prison, he was prisoner number 466 in the year 64. 1964 is when he went to prison. So his prison number was 46664. Interesting number there.
Mm-hmm.
Just coincidence, of course,
sure,
that they gave him that number. Yeah, okay. And he went to prison for being a terrorist. Remember that. But let's look at some pictures here. Very interesting things. Here you have Will Smith at this charity thing that they did, this 46664, and he's holding the hand of Nelson Mandela. When you get to be high-level Hollywood actor, you've done some real sick stuff to get there, okay? You're into witchcraft. You're into all kinds of Satanism and things like that. You've been sold to the devil. Basically, is how the thing works. But, very interesting number choice there. Let's go to another picture here. Here you have Brad Pitt looking like a little, like he's in under some kind of mind control trance there. Just totally out of it. And beside him, you have these two billionaires. The one guy behind the Paul Mitchell or something hair line of products. The other guy behind the Virgin Records, I think it is. Both of them are multi-billionaires. Standing there, with Nelson Mandela. You know, these billionaires are all for what the Mandela was. Here's another picture which is rather interesting. You see, I don't know who these the two on the outside there are, but it's Lionel Richie in the middle, another singer. And they're covering up the two fours with the thing, and it's 666. And I'll show you a little bit more of the logo underneath that here in just a minute. Isn't that interesting?
And it confirms and the King James Bible about being in the hand.
I didn't get to that yet.
Sorry.
You're ruining it.
You put it in my head.
She's ruining the surprise.
I'm innocent.
See? That's what I get for having a woman in the video with me. I'm joking. The witches are screaming and shrieking in horror at my chauvinistic attitude. Yeah, whatever. Those of you who are you know, faithful viewers, you know better. We just kid each other all the time. But, you know, anyways, here again you have Brad Pitt behind Nelson Mandela. You know, oh, he's such a hero. He's such a good guy. Yeah, huh, sure. But check out this. Nelson Mandela at this big event thing. 46664, it's in our hands. Now you tell me that that's a coincidence. The mark of the beast. I mean, are you 4666? For the people? No, nothing like that. They wouldn't be saying any coded messages there. And it's in our hands. Wait a second. No, because you see, the King James Bible has been in error for years and years and years. You see, Revelation chapter 13, verse 16 says, "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads." That's been an error. The King James Bible's an error. And I can show you it's in the same, these ones over here too, but it's always said in, not on. All the other new versions have changed it to on or upon. So that it couldn't be in the right hand. Oh, but actually, yes, it is, because it says it right there.
And he's loading up his right hand.
How about that? Yeah. It's in his right hand. Coincidence.
Sure.
Coincidence. I mean, because if the Mark of the Beast comes out, one group you can be sure of, it's not going to take it, and that's Hollywood celebrities.
Right.
Never take it. They would never promote it. Don't even think about it. On to the next picture. You can even get a t-shirt there if you're interested. I'll show this picture here. 4664. It's in our hands. I mean, it's just so blatant, you know? But here you have Nelson Mandela International Day for Freedom, Justice, and Democracy. Yeah, okay.
Sophistry like freedom, no other.
Freedom. We're going to kill you. We're going to put tires filled with gasoline or diesel and burn your head off. And we're bringing you freedom. Democracy. Yeah, sure. Justice. So they're going to make it the 18th of July, I guess, Nelson Mandela Day, if you're dumb enough to follow it. But notice, again, you have the hand. The hand. And that down there at the bottom, the rainbow-colored hand. And you notice in the second video we did, it talks about, what was the thing, a rainbow? He wanted to make it a rainbow nation or something like that? South Africa?
Nelson Mandela's goal was to make South Africa a rainbow nation. I.e., a nation of perverts.
Yeah.
And perversion, care of the Jesuits and the Vatican.
Yeah. And if you saw my study on anti-miscegenation laws, you know that the two men here in America that overthrew it, the Loving versus Virginia case, both men were Jesuits. One was trained at Georgetown. I forget where the other one was trained, but they were both Jesuit lawyers. One of them was a Jew. Yeah, Bernard Cohen, I think his name was, or whatever, but it's insanity. And here's the interesting thing. Once they overthrow segregation or anti-miscegenation laws, in other words, you can't marry people of other races and things like that. Once they overthrow those, sodomy comes in next. Just like old Nelson Mandela did there. Disgusting. This is what we're dealing with, people. There again, you have the thing, 4666-4, it's in our hands. So, just incredible. But you say, I don't have my pictures on here, but I'm going to be putting them in the study. You say, but I don't understand, what's Nelson Mandela's connection to the Catholic Church? You know, I'm a faithful Catholic. How would he be connected? Well, here's a picture of him as a Knight of Malta.
In full uniform.
Sure. Yeah. And here's another pictures of him. We'll be putting these up of him meeting with Pope John Paul II. Oh, isn't that nice? You know, world leaders getting along and things like this.
Unity across the world.
Yeah. Yep. You see, you can't have a new world order unless you have integration. You can't have a new world order unless you come in and destroy all the agrarian type economies, which we'll be talking about that in a future study. You see, the millennial kingdom that Jesus Christ rules and reigns, he'll be in Jerusalem ruling and reigning the whole earth. That millennial kingdom that's coming, and don't tell me Jesuit futurism. You're an idiot if you believe that, okay? The Jesuits don't teach this pre-millennial, pre-time of Jacob's trouble catching away. They don't teach that. They never have, all right? Quit lying about it. Stupid. But what Jesus Christ sets up is an agrarian society. In other words, what is agrarian? It means people are not, they don't have heavy industry and all this other money and things, the capitalistic system. It's not communistic. It's agrarian. You grow your food, right?
And
you
your medicine are herbs that God created.
Yes. You rely on nature, right? That's the system that God is going to be setting up for the thousand-year millennial kingdom.
I can't wait.
Yeah. It's going to be a wonderful time.
Oh, boy, I cannot wait for that.
And it's interesting because you can do that somewhat today. You can get heirloom seeds and stuff like this, and you can go organic and be off-grid and whatever. But you're still going to be dealing with wild animals and stuff like that come in, you know, and kill all your chickens that in the evening or something or whatever, you know, eat your crops or something. If you're not growing meat, you should, but another issue. But, you know, in the millennial kingdom, the wild animals actually will get along with man. Why? Because the creator is physically on the earth for that thousand-year period of time. So that's why the New World Order integrationist Antichrist movement is so dead set against God's system, that agrarian system. So they go into third world countries, which oftentimes the people are far healthier than first world countries, you know, because they're growing their own food off the land.
And
they're
smarter.
They're self-sufficient, you know. They aren't dependent upon grocery stores and all the money that you have to make just to make your ends meet. It's insanity, you know. But they'll go in there and they destroy that. And they bring in all the heavy industry, which pollutes the environment and destroys people, puts people into debt, makes you indebted slaves to the system. Capitalism and communism, neither of those are God's systems. Okay, capitalism is based upon 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. Right, and I know you can get into all a little, but what about this kind of capitalism or that little? I believe that the system God wants is agrarianism. That's what he sets up in the millennial kingdom. Monarchy, absolute monarchy, with the people living on an agrarian type of level, if you will. So it's interesting that they would come in and they, first of all, they take people out of the bounds of their habitation. What do you think the forced integration is going on there in Europe and coming to America? Too, by the way, the Syrians being brought in, the Syrian refugees, young men, you know, of a military fighting age, being brought in to cause trouble and things like this, Muslim terrorism, you know, what's going on there? It's the Jesuits that are behind this whole thing, integrating all different countries, tearing down laws of segregation. And by the way, segregation is a good thing.
Absolutely. Right?
You learn that if you are agrarian. You don't just say, you know what? I'm just going to plow up the field and let's take a, give me the potato seeds and the tomato seeds and the corn seeds and the squash and green beans and peppers and whatever else. Let's just stir them all together here in a bowl and we'll just kind of fling them out over the, you know, you don't do that. You segregate into different patches. That's what you do. It's not because you hate one type of vegetable and love another. No, you segregate. Anybody that has common sense, anybody that knows anything about nature, realizes segregate. It's smart.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's not wicked. It's not a sin. Again, watch my study on the whole interracial marriage thing. All right? If you can stomach it. Most people can't because they're too closed-minded. Their brains have been, you know, washed clean by the Vatican-controlled media.
By the mental hygiene of the Jesuits in the Vatican.
Yeah, through public schooling, through university training, which is Jesuitical. But I just find this so interesting, this study, because what they're trying to bring out is just, I mean, it's the mark of the beast system. Integration, bringing all the people together. Again, we talk about that in the second video, so I'm not going to cover it again here, but Genesis chapter 11, they try to build a Tower of Babel, you know, that whole thing. God confounds their language. Why? Because they're all coming together. God told them to spread out. They're all coming together. God confounds their languages and forces them to separate. So don't tell me, and there's nowhere in Scripture where God undid that, where God says, hey, I want everybody to come together. I want all people to come together. You know, the only place for that is in heaven, right, where we are given incorruptible bodies. But never on the earth do you see God saying, everybody get together. Let's all come together. You're not going to see that in the Bible. So when you have people saying that, you're not dealing with people that are working for God. At least, you know, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. They work for the God of this world, lowercase g. But that's another story. What time do we have here? 46 minutes in. Tell you what we're going to do. I think we can make this thing happen in one video. I'm actually going to show you the disputed verses here over the overhead camera setup. And just going to show you a little quick little segment here. It's not even a segment. I'm just going to show you a screen capture. This is, I was made aware of this by someone, one of my viewers, and they said there's a guy named Photo Helix. And I watched a couple of this guy's videos, at least what I could stomach of it. Hey, the guy is so possessed with devils. I mean, he's disgusting, you know, claiming to be a Christian. And the guy is like, he's out there, majorly out there. And he's such an idiot. You know, he comes out and he's like talking about how that Matthew 9, verse 17, the King James Bible always said wineskins and now it says bottles. Oh, no. And he's like, they haven't changed it in everything, though. And he shows this Bible lists or something book and it still says wineskins in here. And the stupid idiot is showing the thing. I'll put this up on the screen here. And you can see his one finger is pointed towards Matthew 9, 17, where it says wineskins. And his other finger there, it looks over here and it says NIV NRSV. And it's down here below his finger, below this old wineskins, it says KJV. Below that, it says NIV. So his proof that the King James Bible always said wineskins is some, you know, book that quotes verses from all different versions. And I'm going to show you the King James Bible never, ever, ever said wineskins. Never. It always said bottles. I'm going to show you the proof. And in fact, I'm going to show you what Bible did say wineskins, what introduced it, the word wineskins, when it came in. Okay? So, let me see what other pictures I have here quick, if I can show any more. Okay, I'll have to show those in the next or last part of this. Okay. All right. So, let's get the overhead camera going here. I have to move this microphone back a little bit so I can get this thing working here. All right, now we're just going to show what I'm going to do because I've already checked these. They all say the same thing, all my King James Bibles. So what we're going to do is I'm going to give you my Bible there and I'm going to get this one. This is the oldest one that I have in my collection. Let's come in here. I have to zoom in pretty good on this one because it's very, very, very small print. Here it is. This one, I'll show you the inside of it. Really, really, really neat old Bible. Printed in London, actually. 1828. All right. This is an original 1828 King James Bible. All right. This is the real deal. Now, the first one that they'll say is Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It always said heavens, and now it says heaven. Well, let's look about that. Turn into Genesis 1, 1 in the new one there, my newer Cambridge edition. Here we have 18:28. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I thought it's been changed. Oh, it doesn't look like it. And just to show you, here's my newer Cambridge. Excuse me. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I guess it's not been changed. It's still the same. Next, let's go to, this is the big one, the whole Isaiah 11, verse 6. Turn there. This is the one people say, you know, oh, it's definitely been changed. I remember it being different. I remember. Yeah, I'm sure you remember plenty of things. And I'm, you know, oh, you're being so sarcastic. Well, yeah, that's kind of how it works. All right, here, where are we at here? We have Isaiah 11. There's Isaiah 11, verse 6. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf, and the young lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb. You see it there? All right. My modern Cambridge. Show it this way. It's zoomed in pretty good here. Isaiah 11. Chapter 11, verse. Let's see if I can lift this thing up. I gotta get it over top of the other one there. Okay. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid and the calf, and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The wolf with the lamb. All right. So next we're going to go to, where are we at here? Number 3, Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. And we're going to be talking about, because I know somebody's going, well, all the Bibles have been changed. We're going to talk about that. Just stick with me here. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. Now, they'll say that it used to say, judge not, lest ye be judged. That's what they say. All right. So here we have the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 1. Judge not that ye be not judged. Exactly as my newer King James Bible says. Judge not that ye be not judged. Just kind of wrecks the theory, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Just kind of takes the wind right out of the sails of the conspiracy witchcraft spell. That's the point. Matthew chapter 9, verse 17. Turn over a couple pages to Matthew 9, 17. Okay. Now here's the, it should have been wineskins. It was always wineskins, not bottles. They didn't have bottles in the first century. What was the potter doing there, you know? People that made pottery, you know, they didn't make bottles. They only made wineskins out of pottery. Yeah. Here we go. Matthew 9, 17. I'll show you here. Chapter 9 in Matthew, verse 17. Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish. But they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. Isn't it amazing how CERN was able to change this 1828 Bible and get all the stains and all the coloring of the old page, 200-year-old Bible almost here. They were able to just get it perfectly there like that. Isn't that amazing? Hmm. Or maybe they didn't change it. Maybe, just maybe. Go figure, you know? Matthew 9:17. Okay, this is going to be tricky doing this one. Let's see, where are we at here? Show you Matthew 9. Sorry about this. I'm trying to get this thing positioned here. Verse 17. Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break. And the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish, but they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. Exactly, word for word, as it says in a Bible that's nearly 200 years old. And you know, isn't it a nice thing, too, by the way, as a King James Bible-believing Christian, to know that your Bible's been around for over 400 years? Not some Johnny-come-lately. Been tried and proved by Christians for 400 years. It's nice, isn't it?
Amen.
No other English Bible can attest to that. You say, what about the older ones, the Geneva Bible and stuff like that? They haven't been tested and proved by Christians for 400 years. Or over 400 years. God dumped the Geneva Bible. From the right family of manuscripts, fine, nice, and everything else, but God's hand of approval is on this book right here. This King James Bible, or this King James Bible, or that one, or that one, or the brand new one on the shelf at the store. That King James Bible that nobody's going to change. But let's go to the next one here. In case you're not convinced yet, Luke chapter 5. This thing is so fragile, that's why I'm having to really be careful with how I'm turning it. Luke chapter 5, verse 37. Again, we have the thing of the wineskins versus the bottles. You're going to see. Here we have Luke. There's chapter 6 is what is on this page here. It starts chapter 6 down there. You can see it. No man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. All right. Let me show you the... Just put this thing here like this quick for a moment. I'm going to zoom out a little bit, make it a little bit easier on us here. Where's it? Verse 37. Verse 37 is right there. Luke 6 starts here. Verse 37, no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. There you go. All right. But you say, where did this whole thing of the wineskins come from? Did the King James Bible ever say that? No, it did not. Move that to the side just for a minute. I'll show you this gigantic big old thing here. This is 1892. It's been rebound. I had a brother send this to me. Just in case you're wondering here, where's the title page? Okay. 1892. A.J. Holman and Company, 1892. There you can see it. Okay. Now, this is a revised version of Westcott and Hort on, just to show you here how this thing works. This column here is revised version. This column here is the authorized version, also known as the King James Bible. This side here. That's how the thing is working out here. So let me flip this thing open. Okay, so we have Matthew 9:17. See if I can get this thing on camera. Okay, here you have your King James Bible. I'll stick that microphone over there. Okay, King James Bible. You see bottles, 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 bottles. But what happens over here with the revised version, the Westcott and Hort? Uh-oh, wineskins. Skins, wineskins. Westcott and Hort, Brooke Foss, Westcott, Fenton, John Anthony Hort, two lost hellbound scholars. Well, they're not hellbound because they made it there. They've achieved their goal of being in hell. They're there now.
Weeping and wailing, you know, and gnashing of teeth for all of eternity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
praise the Lord, those two devils are in hell.
Yeah. He said, well, you shouldn't have that kind of an attitude, because I know we're going to get that in the comments. You shouldn't have that kind of attitude. You realize how many people they sent to hell with their new versions?
And are still sending?
Yeah. They messed with God's word. All right. Serious thing. But these two men, Hort, Westcott and Hort, these two men were into many of the same things that Fiona Broom is into. They were into the ghostly guild and other things like that. Necromancy, contacting dead spirits, devil spirits. These are the guys that brought out, that introduced the Vatican manuscripts, the Alexandrian text, that wrote this corrupted text over here that led to over 200 new versions since then. All right. These were the men that started the whole movement. They were very, very wicked. And isn't it interesting that the same groups that they hung out with, people interested in contacting the dead, are the same people today that are now attacking the King James Bible with this Mandela effect. And they're using Westcott and Hort's translation and saying the King James Bible used to say wineskins. The King James Bible never said wineskins. Right? They're lying. They are absolutely lying. Which, they're of their father the devil. He was a liar from the beginning and abode not in the truth. John chapter 8, you can read about that. But then over here in Luke chapter 5 verse 37, just to show you really quickly here, King James Bible, bottles, bottles, bottles. And again, this is 1892. I mean, compare the text of this 1892. You can see how old this thing is. 1892 with my Bible, and this thing's been pretty heavily worn too. I mean, it's you know, aged itself quite a bit here, but look at the difference in the color of the page. White and new, old. So don't tell me, oh well, it's been changed and thing. How did they, if they rewrote this thing, how on earth did they get it aged again? That somehow it changed the term bottles. It used to be wineskins, and they changed it to bottles, and somehow were able to get the text exactly right, and the collar behind the thing exactly right, you know?
And yet you get that it can age with tea. You can't age this type of page with tea.
Yeah, but you get professional book restoring, you know, people that restore books, rebind books and things like this, and there are parts of this book that they had to put like that, the white around it, because the edges of the pages are so ruined. And you can clearly see where it's been patched. You can clearly see where they've had to add things to the pages. See if I can get that over there. Interesting. But what about the revised version here in verse 37? Again, wineskins. Not bottles, but wineskins. Oh, the King James Bible used to say wineskins. It never said wineskins, like I said before. It never did. Never, ever, 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 ever. And these people that are telling you that, they are witches, Jesuit, Vatican witches, casting spells upon you, trying to bring you into their magical system. But get the Bible there again.
Through fear and bondage.
Let's look at the next one here. Luke chapter 6, verse 1. Because they'll tell you another one is they'll say, you know what, take that thing down. We're done looking at that one down. Now, excuse me. You can take that thing and put it on the floor or something or whatever. Luke chapter 6, verse 1. And it came to pass on the second Sabbath after the first that he went through the corn fields, and his disciples plucked the ears of corn and did eat, rubbing them in their hands. All right? Corn. And they say, it's not corn, it should be grain. They didn't have corn until they came to the New World. This is an old debate going back and forth with between the new versions and the King James Bible. It shouldn't say corn. Well, back in 1611, corn meant grain. Okay? It was just another name for that. Again, it does not disprove the King James Bible. It's absurd. But what's the 1828, original 1828 edition say here? Chapter 6, verse 1. Let me zoom in here so you can see it. Get a good shot of this. He went through the corn fields, and his disciples plucked the ears of corn and did eat, rubbing them in their hands. Oh, the King James Bible used to say grain. It never said grain. You know, and again, a lot of these new versions, they will, you can tell you what, you can go to Luke 19, verse 27. A lot of the new versions, you know, they will change things, and then they come along and they say, well, the King James Bible should say this stuff. It's absolutely ridiculous. Let's see, Luke 19, 27. It's difficult turning this little thing. There's, yeah, 1927.
There.
Okay, now this one they say, it should say, show him, not slay before me. Show before me is what it's supposed to say. So here we go with verse 27. It says here, but those mine enemies which would not that I should reign over them, bring hither and slay them before me. Luke 19. There you go. And look right above it. Slay them before me. In the more modern My Cambridge King James Bible. Luke 19. 27. Slay them before me. Slay them before me. Okay, and finally, and I know that there's a bunch more and stuff, and you know, I'm not going to keep playing the little game of let's look up verses that have been changed. No verses have been changed in the King James Bible. Don't give me that. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 23. This one is funny. I'm going to show you a little comment here in my from my CERN video that I did making fun of it, you know, this whole conspiracy thing. And, you know, what I said in the video is actually true. CERN, the Catholics and Evangelicals relying on the Nestle's text, you know, C-E-R-N, get it? A little joke. They have changed the Bible, but not the King James Bible. They've just changed. You know, they keep trying to come out and change things. But this guy says in the comments here, he says, 2 Timothy 2:23, but foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. I definitely know gender was not there. I remember generate strife. And then he quotes a bunch of other translations. Where did your memories come from there, brilliant man there? It came from the other versions, not the King James Bible. All right, we'll start out here in 2 Timothy 2:23. In my King James Bible, it's marked up with color and everything here. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 23, but foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. Oh, see, that's so terrible. I'm sure it's going to be different in this 1828 edition. You know it's got to be different because this guy commented and said so. Okay, here we go. At the bottom of the page, but foolish and unlearned questions. Go to the next page. Questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. Kind of an interesting verse to end this little thing on here. Foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. Is this Mandela effect thing creating peace in the body of Christ or strife? Strife. Right? Of course. Yeah. Trying to get you to doubt the book that God gave you. And by the way, I just want to say this too about this thing of Genesis 1:1. The King James Bible used to say heavens and now it says heaven. No, actually, the King James Bible, the Oxford editions, will actually say heavens, whereas the Cambridge will say heaven. And I stick with the Cambridge King James Bibles. I don't mess with the Oxford ones. Okay, most of the changes are not huge doctrinal types of things, but I stick with the, you know, Cambridge King James Bible. But you say, what's the, you know, well, let's go over some questions here, because I know this is what people are going to write in the comments. Okay, well, let me give you a couple questions that I would have to ask you. If you're still sticking to this stupid nonsense of this Mandela thing, if you are, you're a witch of some kind. I mean, you know, if you're naive, I've seen people that are like, you know, Bible-believing Christians, and they're going, you know, they're saying, you know, what about this thing? It's kind of weird. I don't know. But I see these people, and they're like, you're wrong, you're a heretic. I've been reading the King James Bible far longer than you have, you know, and you don't know the Bible if you don't believe it's been changed and stuff like this. You know, you're a witch or Jesuit or something like that. That's the group that's doing this. The New World Order people, the One Worlders. They're trying to tear down people's faith in this King James Bible. But let me ask you a couple questions. If you've made it this far in the video, which I doubt you have, because most witches are rather stupid and immature people, very prideful. I've run into a few of them out going door to door and things like this. They're very prideful people, very narrow-minded, very thick-headed.
I was born to
bigoted.
To a family of witches, i.e. Jesuits.
Yep.
So
yeah.
I'm familiar with the propaganda.
Question number one. When did these changes happen? If you're still sticking with this story, when did the changes happen? Give me an approximate time period. When did these changes that you say are there, when did they happen? Asking a scientific question. Number two, how did they change printed words? That's a good question. I mean, how can a machine come in? When you get scanners, even the very best scanners, you move a page just a little tiny bit, it'll blur it. How are you going to get a machine to go all over the world and hunt down King James Bibles? They don't mess with the new versions for some weird reason. I don't know why that would be. But how do you get a machine, some scientific machine, that can alter time and reality? And it can somehow get through the leather here and through the whatever, and it can go in and change key words in the King James Bible. How does that happen? And then leave no trace. I show you my old Bibles over here, and, you know, the color of the text is still there, the word, the print, and everything else. Stains on the verses and things from over the centuries.
Without the text being smeared from liquids being spilled on it.
Yeah. Yeah. How do you do that? Next question. Why do the old ones match the newer one? And to go along with that, you say, well, CERN, you know, let's go with some of these theories here. CERN, did CERN travel back in time to change the King James Bible? Did they travel back in time to change this King James Bible? That's my another question. And if so, why didn't anybody notice it in the past? Until just now. I mean, if the King James Bible was changed because they went back in time to change it, if you would say, well, they don't have the technology to go in and change it, but it was changed at the printers, why didn't anybody else notice it in the past? I mean, I showed you 1828. You mean to tell me? That's the same in these other two as well. I'm not showing them for the sake of time. I mean, it's the same. You can, you know, take my word for it, or if you're a witch and quite hateful, then you probably aren't going to take my word, but that's your problem. But they say the same thing. So did they go back in time to 1828 and change it at the printing shop? Why didn't anybody notice it back then? But if CERN managed to change all King James Bibles, you say they just, well, they changed them, you know, they didn't have to go back in time, they just change them as they are. Okay, if that's your theory, then let me ask you a question. How do you set your special little computer science machine, how do you set it to change Bibles that don't even look the same? Here you get a black King James Bible, newer one, Cambridge. Here you get this old one. They're not the same size. How would a computer tell the difference between the two without opening it up? Because somehow they're changing the words while they're closed and on the shelf. All over the world. And then you get this one. Hold the other one up there, please. You get this one from 1868. Says the same things. You get this big pulpit Bible there from 1846. This one. So the machine was able to tell that this one and that one and that one and that one, they're all King James Bibles. Oh, but it gets worse. How about a black one with red? How would the computer know that? How about black with a brown spine? It's getting more difficult. How about red leather with gold edge? Oh no. Boy, there's a lot of things you got to set into your computer to make it go around and look out for all of these different ones. Here's one for women. Fluorescent pink leather with a black spine and gold gilt edge. Set that one into the computer for sure. And another black one with a different design here, leather spine that comes like this, and gold edge. And the computer has to be able to tell that all of these are King James Bibles and somehow get in there and change the words within the King James Bibles.
And how can the computer read what's inside the Bible when it's closed, especially when even if you take a page, you turn to a page and you hold it up to light, you're going to have printing on both the front and the back side of the page, plus the printing on the next front of the next page. And when those are all smushed together in one big pile or layer upon layer of words, how can the machine look through the letter on top of letter on top of letter on top of letter and say, that's a T, that's an I, that's a B, that's a G, whatever? Mm-hmm. Yeah. How can it distinguish between the letters when they're piled on top of each other?
Yeah. You know how? By people being gullible enough to actually listen to this nonsense. It's idiocy. It's beyond idiocy. You see? But the Vatican and the witches all working together, CERN working together, bringing out this satanic terrorist, Nelson Mandela, and little sick inside joke, it's in our hands. You know, this campaign 4666, we're 4666.
For the people.
Yeah, for the people. 4666. Four. It's a sick inside joke. But the target of this thing is this King James Bible. Why is that? Because this is God's book, people.
And the Satanists know it.
They don't.
The King James Bible is God's perfect word.
Absolutely.
They know
it. Absolutely. But you're still denying it. Some of you are still saying, well, you know, I'm going to give you an even stronger proof that the King James Bible has not been changed. You ready? Let me play something for you.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb. Judge not that ye be not judged. Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish. But they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. And it came to pass on the second Sabbath after the first that he went through the cornfields, and his disciples plucked the ears of corn, and did eat, rubbing them in their hands. But those mine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, bring hither, and slay them before me. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes.
How about that? You say, what was that? Well, that was Alexander Scorby. Now, if the King James text has been changed, then why is it that Alexander Scorby is reading the same verses? Just like your King James Bible, any edition of any time period of the King James Bible reads exactly the way that Alexander Scorby reads the Bible. Oh, and by the way, Alexander Scorby recordings were made first in 1953, then in 1972 was his final recordings that he made. Oh, and he died in 1985, February 22nd, 1985. So don't tell me, well, they contacted him and they changed it. Time to give up the scam, okay?
Time to break the spell.
Yeah. There are no changes to the King James Bible, all right? And if you're going to continue posting that kind of satanic filth on my website, then let me just give you a little bit of advice, okay? You better repent. You better repent quickly. Witchcraft, Jesuitry, Roman Catholicism, Masonry, Integrationism, those are all satanic traps. And if you're part of the New World Order movement, if you're one of these little Psy-Op goons out there, you're going to go to hell and you're going to burn. I don't even know why you'd be part of something so stupid, right? You're a loser. That's the whole truth of the matter, right? I mean, and I'm going to tell you right now, if I see this kind of junk in the comment section of this video, I'm going to ban you. I'm going to block you. Because you're not here for truth. You are here to spread disinformation. And the Lord Jesus Christ is going to rebuke you.
Harshly.
Yes. You're going to end up in hell with your rulers and your leaders that are all working together. And if you're a low-level witch or low-level Catholic, whatever else, understand, you're part of the New World Order system, whether you believe it or not, whether you understand it or not. This stuff all ties back, and they're all united against one book. Mm-hmm. If you're an atheist, you should think about that, because your philosophers also tie back to the Jesuit order. You can do the research on that. You're part of the New World Order system. And you do well to study this book, this King James Bible. Read it. And you'll see that actually this King James Bible, you'll be in agreement with a lot of things in this book as an atheist. So what are you talking about? This book's against organized religion. This mm-hmm. book speaks against church buildings mm-hmm. and things like that. You'd be surprised if you actually open your mind enough to do some study and do some research on your own.
This book is vehemently opposed to integration. Mm-hmm. And it is impossible for a person to say, I'm a King James Bible believing born again Christian, but I stand for integration. You're a Satanist if you stand for integration. Mm-hmm. No real King James Bible believing Christian stands for integration.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and again, brethren, you know, oh, you shouldn't get so upset about this and everything. Haven't you seen enough in this study? Haven't you seen this murderer, Nelson Mandela, how he's tied into the thing of anti-apartheid? Watch the other video that comes after this one where we're showing this stuff online. I mean, look up the pictures of the necklacing thing. It's very graphic. It's horrible to look at how he burned people to death, just like the Catholics did for thousands of years.
Just like the Jesuits torture people, you know, by various means.
Yeah, the Inquisition and things. I mean, people, it's this system. It's all working together to tear down your faith in this book. Because this book, they can't control. This book is a supernatural book, and they can't mess with it. That's why they hate it so bad. That's why the Jesuits actually tried to kill King James and the members of Parliament before this book could come out. That's why they offered their own version in 1610, the Dewey Reams Bible, 1 year before this came out. And 400 years later, in 2010, before the anniversary of this thing, they re-released the NIV. Came out, we're going to make a new NIV and everything else. And the Catholics were all excited about this new NIV coming out. I've documented that in my Real Bible Version Issue Exposed film that's available on this channel and on my secondary channel. You better wake up. So that is going to be it. If you're a Bible-believing Christian, don't let anybody shake your faith in the book. This is the greatest book that's ever been written. All right? So, pretty ridiculous.
Yeah.
This whole system. But you can see how the Antichrist system is going to come in and how they're going to persecute those who stand by this book. Because you see, the rapture is coming soon when the body of Christ is called out. And when we leave, it's going to very much verify that we had the right book and we had the right faith, because the King James Bible believers are leaving, the new versionists, the integrationists, the Catholics, the witches, the whatever heretics out there,
they're going to be staying.
It's going to be shown who was right and who was wrong. Make sure that you're saved and go with us.